Welcome to my program on understanding Buddhist way of life. I am Bante Suthadara. Buddhism was introduced to the world by a great person called the Buddha. Many of you already know, long time back. But it has been a system that was living among people, living in people for a long time. My intention is to explain few things about Buddhism to be used in your day-to-day life. To understand Buddhist way of life, first we have to look at the world, how Buddhism explains the world. In general, in the world, we can see that there are many extremes. We can call it maybe there are people who are very idealistic and there are people who are very materialistic. So between this idealism and materialism, so we think in general that okay, if all the material things that we want are there for us, then our life is going to be happy. And those who don't like this, or probably they understand that materialistic things are not going to make a happy person, then some people just throw away everything that they use as different equipment, different things, different ways of life and what are needed in day-to-day life, and go to an extreme self-mortification, what we called in a technical way, to give pain and try to find happiness through pain. Happiness through pain and happiness through other material gains, those are two different extremes. Buddhism came to the world, or Buddhism was introduced to the world in a more realistic way. To live a happy life, you need things, and you can be happy with the needs when the needs are met, and rather than your wants. It is easy to say that, but first we have to change our way of thinking to see the realities in life. When you look at the world, we can see that there are so many things in the world, so many new inventions every moment, every day. We get new gadgets, new things. Some people are very reluctant to use all this new technology, new things. They say that those are not needed. But we can use all this, but you don't have to be attached to it. And then we identify with all these things. This identification with the things, not only the things, even with ideas. We are very much attached to our views, ideas, beliefs. The Buddha explained to us, if we want to live a happy life, we have to understand the world. To understand the world, then what is the way? You go around and analyze everything in the world? No, it is not possible. Then you have to get a sample of data from the world. So my data sample is going to be my whole body. And what is in the world is there in my body too. And not only the body and mind. Then how do we look at this? We look at, as Buddhists, we look at the world as a changing entity or changing organism. And at the same time, we give highest recognition for human life as well among other life forms. We don't degrade or deny any other life form, but human beings are capable of changing their ways, attitudes, their way of living, and they are there for their growth. Not at the same time, we have the choice. Either we can progress or we can go down. We choose it not to go down or not to go in a very harmful way to ourselves and others. So to do all these things, what we have to do is that we have to really understand the world. Understand the world means, then, as I earlier mentioned, it is a changing entity. But change, we see all the time. Oh yes, we see the change. Someone said that, okay, when you look at a stream of water, it's always changing. And the lights always changing. Things are always changing. It is true that our knowledge says that, okay, everything changes. It's hard to catch it when the change goes on. We see when the change already happened. So we have to see the ongoing change. When we see the change, then our attitudes are going to be changed too. Because we take things in a very static way. We think that, okay, when something wrong happens to me, I think that is the end of my life. And when there is something painful, I think, oh, it is going to be there forever. If I get sick, I think that I am going to be sick forever. So that we become very much, very much static about those things. But the Buddha said that we have to look at everything in the fast changing form. It is not there for any 2 seconds the same way. So if we don't change that kind of way of thinking, then what happens is that we always be imprisoned in our own world and say that, oh, there is no way out of this. Then when we look at this changing world, what happens? It is always changing, it is always impermanent. Then is there any hope for it? Yes. If the change is not there, there is no hope for us to change things for happier ways. Always we think the change happens to give us pain, to take away all the happiness from us. When change happens like that, then we have to have the change to get away that pain or something that is very disadvantageous to our life. Then the Buddha tried to explain to us why all these pains are there. Because we are very much attached to our sensory comforts. And then we think that when those comforts are gone, then we think the life is gone too. Without understanding this momentary change, there is no way we can be happy. That's very simple in that way. To understand this, how do we train ourselves? When we look at our body, what is the place where you can catch this momentary change? Well, we always blink. Oh, then there is some change. But more than that, even if I don't have my eyes, still I can find a way of changing in my body. What is that? I always breathe in and breathe out. When I breathe in, I can feel, I can see that my abdomen, tummy is rising, and when I breathe out, it is falling. Either rising or falling, or when I breathe in, breathe out, then there is momentary change, and it is actually that easier for us to experience it. So Buddhist way of life teaches us to observe this change. Okay, by the end of this discussion, I will explain how to observe this breath, in-breath and out-breath. When you look at our breathing process, we always breathe in, breathe out, breathe in, breathe out. We never pay attention to it. And also we can, if you want, you can connect ourselves with the breath, our all experience with the breath. When I see something, I can observe. I am breathing in, I am seeing. I am breathing out, I am seeing. I am hearing. I am breathing in, I am hearing. I am breathing out, I am hearing. It's possible. What happens when we do this? When we do this, what happens is that we are keeping our mind, ourselves together with the body, and we are not letting our mind to go away. Because we connect the mind with the present moment. Unless we are, what are we doing? Always our mind is either connected with the past or connected with the future. What is wrong with connecting with the past and future? I'm not telling it is wrong or right, but when you look at your past, it is not easier to remember many pleasant experiences that we had sometimes. Sometimes we are always thinking about something bad happened too. It depends on how your attitudes are too, it's true. When we connect ourselves with the past, what happens is that then our mind is in control. Mind start controlling us. Then our fears are arising. We get afraid of this because I had this experience before, so it is going to be wrong, it is going to be a disaster again. And at the same time, we want to be better. We want to have better experience too. But still, we have lot of doubts. And the future worries are there. Past, all the negative experiences are there. Then we are wandering around the past and future. What happens is that, are we enjoying our life? No, you cannot say you are enjoying your life. You are idling. Or if I do it, I am idling. Then what can we do about it? We try to catch this momentary change through our breath, in and out breath. Breathing is very important, right? Of course, we know that what happens if you stop breathing. So there is no more that person capable of living here, right? The breath is very important, very crucial for our survival. Then we can look at other experiences in our life, that momentary experiences at the same time, and we have different attitudes towards those. When I see something, I think it is good or it is bad, either good or bad, either pleasant or unpleasant. And then when I hear something, it's nice, or again it is it is not nice. We are always grabbing things or pushing away things. Grabbing and pushing away things create a lot of conflict in a different way. When you grab something, you want to keep those, but the world nature doesn't let us keep those things. Even the most beloved ones cannot be kept with us forever. Even the most beloved thing we cannot keep with us forever. Then when we cannot keep those, when all these loved things go away from us, then we become very sad, very unhappy. Not only that, when unpleasant things are staying with us, we don't want to get sick. When we are sick, we are very unhappy. We don't want very unpleasant people around us. When we have to associate with those unpleasant people, then we are unhappy. Then you look at it, we are very much judgmental beings. We judge things. So can we develop our way of thinking, or can we progress beyond these extremes, likes or dislikes, good or bad, right or wrong? Just look at things as they are. This, when you observe your breath, it gives that neutral point. Breathing in, breathing out, when you observe, it doesn't ask you to have any kind of attachment to it, or any kind of like pushing away from it. It is a natural process, it is going on. So we are there, we are with that. Then we observe it, and we are there, we keep it as our focal point. Observing breath is very important. How do we train ourselves to observe breath? Probably you have already noticed that I am going towards explaining a way of meditating. You can call it meditation or any other name, doesn't matter, but it will give you a lot of strength to face our day-to-day life realities. How are we going to train ourselves? I just ask you to just take 3 breaths. Intentional, you just breathe through your nose, breathe in and breathe out through your mouth for 3 breaths. Okay, that is very essential for the beginning. And then people always say that, okay, I cannot meditate because I cannot empty my mind. I don't ask you to empty your mind. I just ask you to try this method for maybe a couple of minutes a day. You start after these three breaths, you start counting your out breath. You take first breathing in. It's a normal normal natural breathing, and you start breathing in, breathing out, count one. Breathing in, breathing out, count two. Breathing in, breathing out, count as three. Likewise, up to 10, you count your in and out breaths. So complete breath means in breath and out breath. So up to 10. After 10, again count the next breath as 10 and come backward. 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Then again count from 1 to 10. How many breaths are you going to count? Just 33. 33 breaths. Just how many minutes that you need to spend for counting these 33 breaths? It is not going to be even 5 minutes. So just less than 5 minutes, less than 3 minutes probably. And just count and just go into your day-to-day life. You will see the difference. You will see all the life experiences in a different way when you train yourself to do this. Because you are training yourself to be in this moment. Without being in this moment, there is no way we can see things properly. See things in their proper form. So that's the reason that we are trying to train ourselves to do this. Sometimes people think this is extremely difficult. We are scared of stay by ourselves. Even when we drive, we need loud music, some form of connection with the world. But when you breathe in, when you breathe out, are you not connected with the world? Yes, we all are equally breathing in and out. At the same time, when I breathe, at the same time, there are so many millions, billions, billions of people are breathing in and out. We are equal because we breathe in and out. So we don't have to discriminate people on the other things, based on other aspects, other things. We are equal because we are breathing in and out, right? Isn't that enough to think about that human beings, not only because we have same six senses, same type of body, same shape, probably same things, but very subtle way of looking at it is that we all are breathing beings. So we are breathing in and out beings living in this world. So there are millions of people who are breathing in and out. That's a good way to look at the world, and at the same time, that is a good way to connect with the world. We are not alone. Isn't that a nice idea? Isn't that a nice feeling to be connected with the world? So to be connected with the world, just try this. Just 33 breaths. If you have more time, if you like to do it, you can sit down and continue to do it for more than 3-4 minutes, 5 minutes. Just try it. And when you breathe in, out, if you can do it longer, you will first realize how our breathing process is too. when we breathe in through our nose, and our chest is rising, and then the tummy rising, and then when we breathe out, falling, we get to understand our breathing process well. After a while, you will see that there are other things coming in. Or I am thinking of something. Always mind becomes very busy with all these thoughts, and we keep forgetting this or counting of breath. Now don't worry about it. If you forget, you start it over again. Yes. Nobody is going to test you, or nobody is going to give you any mark or anything. It is just for your self-growth. It's going to help you. So what is the guarantee? So just try it and experience it. That's the whole thing about the Buddha's teachings. You have to experience it individually by each person. We cannot just make everyone, maybe even 2 people or 10 people or 100 people, we can make them sit in somewhere. We say that we force them to, okay, sit down, maybe cross-legged, and close your eyes and just meditate. But we cannot make them meditate that way. Each person individually has to do it. Not only that, when we do this, it is a way of connecting ourselves with our life, and we will start seeing things. Even though sometimes you are closing your eyes, you will see things, and also you hear things at that time without passing judgments. Earlier we mentioned about we are very much prone to judge things. Oh, it's horrible. Oh, this is very pleasant. Oh, this is very nice. This is sweet. The taste. Look at the taste. We all eat. We love to eat. We like some people very much. Many people like sweet things. If you ask, do you like bitter things? No. People don't like very much bitter things. So then we say that, oh, it's horrible, it's bitter, it's horrible. But when it is sweet, oh, it's nice. So without passing that judgment, can we just see things, hear things as they are? Or just you just sit down in your office, or you are working somewhere, maybe traffic moves outside, and without any passing judgment, you just observe it as hearing. When you sit, you may feel other things, maybe heat, cold, in weather changes. Just observe it as cold. You can have your whole experience expanded and connected with the world. Some people think that sitting meditation is a way of getting away from life or getting away from the world. I disagree. It is a proper way of connecting yourself with life. It is a proper way of connecting with your world. So the whole world is very important, and you are very important to the world. So this interconnectedness, interdependence, is extremely important for happiness of all. The Buddha's teaching of love, or teaching of loving kindness, is that. So how to connect ourselves, how to understand ourselves through our world experience, and develop empathy, compassion to ourselves and to the others. Let us discuss those things in another day. Thank you for listening to this discussion with and also I request you to just experience little bit, and may you have a happy and long life. Sabbe satta bhavantu sukhitatta. May all beings be well and happy. Thank you.